was a summer night, such a perfect day. We were so laid back, just watching the waves. It was our time, there was no rain. We would just love, then do it all again. The sun set for the last time. Oh, I hate to say goodbye, 'cause we had such a good time. Here's a toast to the good life. I can't stop thinking about the sand in my feet. I got a heartache 'cause cold ain't for me. I wish my worries would wash into the sea, 'cause it's far too cold, darling, cold ain't for me.
Module 9. Listen. B. You will hear an interview with zookeeper Jane Cameron, talking about monkeynomics, an experiment that teaches monkeys to use money like humans do. For questions 1 to 7, choose the best answer, A, B, or C.
Hello, and welcome to our show, Animals and You. Visitors to our local zoo recently have been amazed by the sight of capuchin monkeys going shopping. Zookeeper Jane Cameron is here to explain what all this monkey business going on at our city's favourite zoo is all about. Hi, Jane. It's called monkeynomics, but what exactly is it?
Well, it all began as a bit of a joke, actually. We had heard about research carried out by Yale University psychologist Laurie Santos. She conducted experiments on how monkeys can be taught to spend. To cut a long story short, the monkeys were given coin-like tokens to see if they would trade their coins for food items. We were amused by this idea and felt that we should try it out for ourselves at our zoo.
How did you set up your monkey economy?
We began by monkeying around. We gave the monkeys some coins to play with. First, they stared at these useless metal tokens curiously. They seemed worthless to the monkeys. The situation changed when the monkeys discovered that they could exchange these coins for grapes. The monkeys suddenly got excited about the tokens.
That sounds like a nice trick.
Exactly. At this point, the monkeys looked smart without really being smart. We thought we should stir things up a bit by making some of the zookeepers selling the grapes offer two for the price of one.
What did the monkeys do?
They did what we would all do in their position. They shopped around for bargains. They wanted value for money, just as we do. They also looked at the quality of the grapes. They would take into account quality and quantity when making their decisions about which grapes they ought to buy.
So I guess the monkey marketplace works like a simple human marketplace.
Not so simple, actually. We decided to throw a monkey wrench in the works by introducing some risk. We got two zookeepers offering two grapes each. One would always give the grapes at an ordinary price, whereas the other zookeeper sometimes would give more or fewer grapes than the monkeys had paid for. This made the monkeys think about what they ought to do. To begin with, most of the monkeys thought they should play it safe. At other times, we had two sellers with three grapes each. One of the sellers always offered one fewer, whereas the other trader would give either all three or just one. The monkeys took the risk and treated losses differently to gains, just like we do.
So are you saying that monkeys think like humans? Did any of them think to save money?
No. Just like humans, they spent it immediately. And there was also a lot of stealing going on. They would rip each other off at every available opportunity. In the future, it will be interesting to see if they take loans.
How do you explain these similarities between us and monkeys?
Laurie Santos, the psychologist who first did this experiment, says that we are somehow related to each other. Take away Twitter, mobile phones, computers, and all that other stuff, and put us in the savannah, and you'll find that monkeys aren't just like us, but we are just like them too. In fact, what this experiment actually does is is make monkeys out of us.
Such a perfect day, but we were so laid back, just watching the waves. It was our time, there was no rain, we were just love, then do it all again. The sun set for the last time, oh I'd hate to say goodbye, cause we had such a good time. Here's a toast to the good life. I can't stop thinking about the sand in my feet.
Listen. B. You will hear five different people talking about their experiences as artists. For questions 1 to 5, choose from the list A to H what each speaker says. Use the letters only once. There are three extra letters which you do not need to use. Speaker 1.
As a kid, I used to love reading Peanuts, Asterix, and Lucky Luke. I started out by copying these, and slowly began to come up with my own ideas, inspired by my life. At school, my friends would laugh at some of the caricatures I'd make of other classmates. So I guess you could say I was a natural cartoonist. I enjoyed it so much that I never quite considered doing it for a living. Instead, I enrolled in an economics course at college. That's when my career took off. I had a cartoon strip titled Le Thing in the college paper that an editor of one of the biggest newspapers in the country picked up one day. The next thing I knew is that I had quit economics and was creating cartoons for the press. People just seemed to find them funny. These days, though, I wonder whether I should have stuck with economics. Newspaper sales are dropping, and people just grab my cartoons from the internet, so I don't really get paid for them. On the upside, my cartoons are now available to a greater audience, and the digital age has made it easier for me to create them. It takes just half the time.
Speaker 2. I started writing as a teenager. It helped me figure things out. The words would flow out of my pen as though it had a mind of its own. A poem would write itself. Oh, so that's how I feel, I'd think. Poetry helped me understand myself. It's strange how people think most poets have suffered, isn't it? They believe we lead such sad lives. Others say that in moments of inspiration, most poets are out of their senses. It's called poetic madness. All this is not true in my case. But let me tell you, it is emotionally exhausting displaying your innermost fears and thoughts. Sometimes it's frustrating searching for the right words, rewriting and editing. There's great joy when every word falls into place. I remember the pleasure I felt when I saw my first poem, Lucrezia, published in a magazine. Since then, I've realized that it's easy getting poetry published, but hard to get money for it. That's why I also work as a librarian. It keeps me sane, which is bad for my poetry, but pays the rent, which is good for my health. Speaker 3.
When I first started selling my paintings, I underpriced them, hoping that this would get more people to buy them. It didn't. So I started looking around at galleries. I was surprised to find worthless paintings selling for a fortune. So I increased my prices. Surprisingly, this made people more interested in my work. My career as an artist really took off when I met my wife, a journalist. She convinced me that I had to be nice to the press. When newspapers started writing about me, my art suddenly gained value, even though nothing had really changed. These days, I sell my paintings for a fortune, and art critics keep writing about them. The artist is showing how humans are in pain and how the world is full of confusion, wrote a famous art critic the other day. I didn't do that, did I? I thought. Imagine that. And there I was thinking I'd painted a picture of a black circle and nothing more.
Speaker 4. Painters say that sculptures are what you bump into when you're stepping back to gain a better view of a painting. People underestimate what I do. Is there any purpose or meaning to your work, they ask? Well, I hope not, I say. I think there are already enough meanings in the world to keep art critics busy. I just want to make sculptures that bring joy. If you really want to know the truth, the sculptures make themselves. I never really know what I'm making until I've finished it. I just create as I go. The good thing about being a sculptor is that you never really grow up. You feel like you're still at the playground making mud cakes like the children do and getting dirt under your nails. People sometimes ask me when I plan to get a real job. I have one, I say. I'm a sculptor, aren't I? Speaker 5.
When I first started in this business, all I had was a camera, a couple of actors, and a very small budget. We didn't have much money, but that didn't matter because we had great imagination and loved what we were doing. These days, I have sponsors, producers, designers, cast, crew members, and we're rolling in money. The extra money has created just as many problems as it has solved, though. I'm caught between people above me wanting to know how their money is being spent, and cast and crew members expecting me to solve their difficulties. Creative people have huge egos, and sometimes petty arguments can destroy a film. My job feels like a tightrope walk between creativity, psychology, and finance. One minute I'm a manager, the next I'm a psychiatrist, and then I'm a teacher. In a business where you are only as good as your last film, there is so much pressure to succeed.